Okay. It occurred to me that no one was going to tell me it was time to start, that I was going to actually have to walk up here and get started. But I'm looking at the clock, and we're several minutes past three. I want to be mindful of everyone's time and thank you all for showing up this afternoon. Beautiful, crisp day. Feels good to have true fall finally arrive here. In Marquette. Most of you know I moved here from Montana, and I celebrated quietly because they were hit by a pretty severe snowstorm about a week ago out there, and then basically some near zero degree temperatures. So everyone from Montana who gave me a hard time about moving to the frozen tundra of the Upper Peninsula, I took the opportunity to remind them of the beautiful colors and beautiful weather we had compared to what they were working through. That said, sounds like it's going to be a snowy Halloween. So there we go. It's coming for us as well. I'm going to be very brief, but I do want to set the stage just a little bit before I invite today's presenters to the podium. And what I want to do in terms of setting the stage is explain to you how this university forum and those that follow, there'll be one of these every semester, but how the university forum fits into what I hope is an enhanced kind of internal and external communication strategy that we're adopting at NMU. And I think, to be clear, we do a lot of things and have been doing a lot of things quite well with respect to communication. And I also want to be quite clear that even with some of the changes we have in place, we're going to need to keep working on this and keep getting better. So none of this is meant to be a quick fix. But I hope some things this semester are a step in the right direction. So what's happening? Some of it is really about what I would call ground level interaction with people and units across campus. Just last week, I can't tell you what day it was, maybe Jill you can, but last week I had a chance to visit with Dale Kapla, the biology department, and it kicked off a second set of meetings with all of the academic departments on campus. Now, over lunch, I was reminded that I still have not made it to all of the administrative units across campus, and so I'll work with Laura Glover and make sure that we're getting around and having meetings kind of where you are, and meeting with your staff, if you like, and hearing about your concerns directly from your team. So that's one part of the communication strategy, is just getting out and about a bit more. Of course, we'll have the kind of traditional, you know, digital communications. A lot of that'll be the email updates. We're also looking, you know, getting older every day, but to use some multimedia, you know, social media strategies, especially to reach some of our students who may be more apt to receive messages that way. But we're going to look closely at how we use digital communication as well and on a consistent basis. There are also some kind of new strategies that we're looking at. Today, I did host a lunch with a cross-section of the university. If you attended the convocation ceremony at the beginning of the semester, you'll remember that on each table, there were a set of cards, and the cards allowed convocation attendees to write down names of, like, quote-unquote, unsung heroes. I'm not sure whether that's exactly the right term or not, but these are people across the university who are doing great work and who are not always recognized or not always elevated for doing that work as obviously as they should be recognized. And so, throughout the course of the year, I'm going to have lunch with those groups and just kind of hear about what's happening in their worlds. It's a bit of an ask me anything, tell me anything scenario. What stays in that lunch, or what happens in that lunch, stays in that lunch. And it's a good opportunity, I think, for everyone to share some candid thoughts. There are a number of different kind of ground level events and strategies that we'd like to use, just to really make it clear that there's no hiding the ball. And again, we can always do better. It's hard to communicate perfectly, but the intention is to try to listen, and then it's, I think, an intention to provide information, provide opportunities as for feedback as earnestly as possible. There are a few kind of bigger ticket parts of the communication plan, and this is part of it, but I want to end with today. One part of it, you'll see, I guess starting next month, we're still in October, so next month in November, we'll host the first of our monthly budget workshops, kind of budget academy workshops. I think I came up with that, and as I think about it, I'm not sure the name is quite sensible, but it's a Budget Academy workshop, and Gavin Leach and Matt Franti and others have been kind enough to put time and energy into hosting these every month. They're going to be every month, and what they'll do is they'll talk about a key element of the budget. It could be capital outlay. It could be how we look at operating reserves and deferred maintenance. It could be about how the budget is structured across the new five-pillar framework on campus. But highlighting a piece of the budget, talking about where we are in that year's budget cycle, kind of awareness about what decisions are being made, what information is being gathered at that point in the budget year. And there will, of course, be time for some Q&A. In those workshops, there'll be about 25 or 30 people, and that's intentional. We want it to be a kind of seminar feel where there's a lot of Q&A and a chance to really have a small group presentation and conversation. They will also be streamed so that if you can't attend, you're able to watch that online. And I think those will just go on. And we don't know how many years we're going to do that for, but I think that it's something that will benefit the university as we implement it over the months and years and just kind of increase baseline awareness and opportunities to engage around the budget. So that's one of the three really big pieces. The second of the three really big pieces was last week, the university assembly. And I'm looking around the room. A number of you were at that university assembly meeting. Those will also be held once a semester, always in advance of this event, the forum. So down the road, the university assembly will probably be 2 to 3 weeks ahead of the forum. The assembly will cover items that are sort of developed by the university as a whole. We'll solicit feedback on some agenda items that we have in mind. You'll always have an opportunity to chime in with agenda items for the university assembly that you think are important. We'll host the assembly. So there'll be presentations. We got great feedback from the last assembly. We'll break it up a little bit more. We'll offer opportunities for give and take, some Q&A. We'll figure out kind of what surfaced during the assembly. What do we want to really highlight out of that assembly meeting? Some of that will be what we in turn focus on during the university forums. So it won't always be the case because there'll be other items we want to cover in the forums, but we are going to take what we learned from the assembly and actually move that into much of what constitutes the university forums as we move forward. I never am embarrassed to say, look, this is a work in progress. We wanted to host these this fall, and so we got them up and got them running. I think the assembly was long. It was uninterrupted. There was a ton of information. I'm really happy with how it went, but I think we're getting some good feedback. We'll make some good tweaks as we move forward with that. And guess what? The same thing will be true with today's forum. We'll make some tweaks and improve it over time. I do think the assembly and the forum will work as a tandem moving forward. The other key difference, of course, being that the assembly is assembled. I think Lisa Eckert, I owe you that. In some small group, I said, well, how exactly are we describing the difference between the assembly and the forum? And Lisa said, well, one key way is that an assembly is a group of people who are assembled together. And we did. We've assembled folks by role. There are a couple of hundred people as part of the university assembly. This forum is always meant to be open. And I do see some community members here today. I'm so excited, and thank you for spending time with us. I think in my ideal scenario, there'll be students, faculty, staff, administrators, and community members at each one of these forum events. So without further ado, what we'll have today is a kind of keynote presentation from Vice President Gavin Leach, who will give an overview of this year's budget and some basic budget mechanics. After Gavin is done, he'll also talk about his priorities for the finance and administration pillar, have some time for Q&A, and then he's going to hand it off to the other leaders of the four remaining pillars, Northern Student Experience and Jeff Corpy, Student Affairs and Success, Chris Greer, People, Culture, and Well-Being, Rhea Deaver, and then Academic Affairs, Dale Kapla. If we have time, and I really hope we do, Gavin will also run our bell lap and give an update on data security. Okay. Thanks again for being here. Without further ado, Gavin, I'll hand it over to you. You can come up and talk a little bit about this year's budget. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Brock. So first up, we're going to walk through the university budget. On the agenda today, the discussion is going to surround university operating trends, the most recent budget passed by the university, as well as looking forward already to 24-25, which started as soon as we passed the last budget. And then finally, I'll finish up with the facilities update. First, there's three primary factors that affect the general fund budget, and they're all surrounding, well, most of it surrounds enrollment, which is enrollment and tuition and fees, and then you also have state appropriation. We're going to look at some of the trends that have been happening in this area to try to help understand where our budget's been going. And one of the big trends, and this is common not just in the state of Michigan, but all over the United States, is you can see a trend of dropping enrollments. And it's not just at Northern, you can see all the other schools are down. And it's been a challenge for all of us. And obviously that has a big impact when we look at the budget. During that time period of the last 5 years, we were down 7.5%. And that would equate out to about 517 students during that time period. And when you look at Northern's change over the last 10 years, excluding this year where we're up 2.1%, we're down about 25.5%. And you think of that's 2,100 students over that time period, or in terms of annual revenue, $25 million a year, just to put that in perspective. As we look at state appropriation, the state appropriation has been something that's been fairly stagnant for the universities for many years. In 2002, we received $52 million, and I'm happy to say 22 years later, we're finally just above that mark at about $53 million this year. And you can see what's happened during that time period is the state sort of stagnated on funding or decreased it in many years. The universities used to be primarily funded by state appropriation back in the 90s and 2000s, and today you can see a huge shift where tuition and fees is the primary source of the general fund funding. As far as our competitiveness on tuition rates, we're second lowest, and the state of Michigan instituted a few years back a tuition restraint language, which really limits our ability to raise tuition. And what that does is it's going to keep us in that second or third lowest tuition as long as that language still exists out there. And so you have the constraint of enrollment, then you have constraint in tuition, and you have the appropriation, which, you know, those all have major, major impacts on our budget because those are our primary sources for funding the university. For this year's budget, when we look at the makeup of it, 63% is out of tuition and fees, and 36% is out of state appropriation. And this does not deduct out financial aid, which we would normally do. But you can't have a negative number for financial aid in a pie chart, so we just showed it this way. And then when you look at the expense budget, it's the same way as financial aid we kept in the expense side because we couldn't include in the revenue side just to show the impact overall. And you can see majority of our budget is personnel costs at 54%. And if you took out financial aid and just looked at the other expenses with personnel, that would go up to 64% of our budget is on staffing. When you look at the allocation by division / pillar, you can see academic affairs has a majority. Scholarships is a big piece when we look at it within this budget. If we took scholarships out, academic affairs would be about 52% of the budget. But majority of it's there. You have some scholarships as well as you have some other costs for debt service, technology infrastructure, which is under general university. Now, if we look at this year's general fund budget, and this was what was presented at the board meeting a week or two ago, I can't remember how far back. Seems to be going by real fast these days. You can look at our revenue, and in this one, you'll see the financial accounting where financial aid is deducted from revenues. Overall, we had a $6.6 million increase in overall revenues. And in their revenues, there's a line item. You have state appropriation, which was up 5%, plus recognition of the final adjusted appropriation for last year. We have tuition and fees, which up $4.8 million, and that's about a 5.5% overall increase, and that can be broken down into $2.7 million from on-campus and $2.1 million from global campus on the increase. And that accounts for enrollment rate adjustments. And again, the final total combines out to $4.8 million. On the financial aid side, our regular inflationary cost increases plus the transition to test blind scholarships results in about $650,000 increase. But in addition to that, we had some initiatives that took place with the Bridge Scholarship, which equalizes interstate tuition for out-of-state residents. And the other ones are the Tuition Advantage Program. So students that qualify for the Michigan Achievement Scholarship, if they filed a Pell and qualified for that, we made sure that we filled the rest of their dollars to cover tuition and fees for the school year. And the other adjustments were for need-based aid. We upped that $100,000, so about $880,000 in initiatives for scholarships. And again, we're trying to remove barriers for students to get access to the university. And then finally, we removed the application fee, another barrier for students applying to the university. And it was about $180,000 in revenue, but we're allocating that over a two-year period. On the expenditure side, you can see same $6.6 million in adjustments. The largest portion is personnel compensation costs. And you have about $3.2 million that's a result of contractual compensation increases, promotions, the MOU we did with the TOPS, some minimum wage adjustments, and there are adjustments for global campus staffing and prior year departmental reallocations. In addition, through initiatives and new investments, we added some positions of about $1.3 million. Those included in speech, language, and pathology program, a faculty member, cybersecurity added a faculty member, and social work added an administrative assistant. Admissions, we added two admissions counselors in that number. Well-being, we added an associate vice president as well as a case manager for that area. And child care benefits were about $250,000 that we put in place. And then in public safety, we added, made sure we had 24-hour coverage for our dispatcher, as well as two officers on duty at all times. So those came out to about $1.3 million, combined overall $3.5 million. Oh, $4.5 million. And then MEPSERS, we had an additional pay down of the MEPSERS liability by the state. What that does is reduces the amount of annual payment we need to make to the state by about $1 million. And that $1 million was used as a reduction to bring the $4.5 million to $3.5 million. In the area of supplies, materials, supported designated operations and services, you had about $600,000 in pure inflationary cost increases that included contractual professional development increases, departmental supplies and support increases, software costs, property and liability, as well as travel costs and summer session support. In addition to that, we had $400,000 in investments, primarily in academic labs and classroom supplies, and Title IX compliance, as well as well-being operations, and supportive application development and campus master planning, or strategic planning, I mean. So overall, the combined total of that is $600,000. And finally, you have equipment, library, acquisitions, and reserves. And there's some inflationary adjustments, about $100,000. And then we made a $100,000 increase in the capital equipment replacement program, along with library acquisition increase. Increased the capital renewal budget by about $200,000, and then allocated dollars for Hardin Hall student space on the first floor for future renovations. So those combined ended up at $6.6 million and an overall 5.6% increase in expenditures. And finally, you can see the primary focus of our investments this year, and I talked about new investments in each of those categories. They were focused on five primary areas: academic enhancement, removing barriers to student access, and enhancing campus well-being, experience, and safety, along with supporting new technology development, community outreach, and enhancing and protecting university infrastructure. The combined totals in those investments, which are included in that prior page, is $3.3 million. Since I'm exciting you all right now, I'm going to move on to now we finished the 23-24 budget, which we're current operating in, and now we're already moving on to the 24-25 budget. And I'm just going to talk a little bit about the timeline and process for that. This is sort of a normal process, and I can see a date might not have been updated on the top one, but typically each year we'll submit a capital outlay request in the fall, and that happens in November. And that's an annual process that happens. You never know what year you're gonna get a capital outlay project in. It's definitely not every year, but you keep submitting it. And some years you need to adjust it to align with where the state might be issuing capital outlay. But for right now, the College of Business continues to be our number one capital outlay request. And we continue to pursue that one pretty heavily right now. As you look at the overall state budget, they do an annual budget request, and it's a letter the state says. Some years they don't even send it, but they ask you for various questions related to challenges and opportunities for the university. I've never seen any of these really have an impact on any budget that's gone to state universities in 30 years I've been here, but every year they ask for them. And we continue to fill it out in hopes of some year maybe they'll allocate dollars accordingly. But it is a process that you have to go through, and it's something that's required for future funding. So we make sure we get those in every year. Then in February, the governor releases the exec budget. That's followed by the House and the Senate will pass their budget sometime between February and June. And then between June and September, you have the leadership working out what the final details of the budget's gonna be, and eventually they'll pass it sometime during that time period. We've been years where it's been September 30th before a budget was passed. So it varies every year, you don't know what you're getting, but that is the process. That it used to be it would go to conference committee and then finalize, but in recent years they've just done the leadership working out a final budget. Now, all of that state budget timeline affects NMU's budget timeline. So on the NMU timeline, we look between September and June to get input from our division heads, but the process for that would be department heads and directors providing their division leaders with proposed budget changes. Division leaders prioritize those requests. September to February, new initiatives or investments are proposed through the divisions. And then in February, after release of the executive budget, we start going into putting together preliminary models for the new year to see what potential resources would be available to use to fund these initiatives or proposed enhancements in budgets. And then between February and September, as the state budget models get refined, the House passes a budget, their appropriation may be more or less than the governor's, Senate passes one, maybe more or less, we'll continue to refine our budget according to some of the changes that we're seeing. And then finally, as they get closer, we have to figure out where our parameters are for tuition, because the state changes that on an annual basis. So that takes into account, along with the most recent estimates we have in enrollment, and that's a big part of setting our overall tuition, which would happen normally at the end of June. And then we move between June and September. As things keep changing, we keep remodeling the budget until we get to a final budget that then gets brought forward to the Board of Trustees in September, early October. And then one other note is that during the fiscal year, once the budget's set, divisions and departments can reallocate funds within their department or division to meet the needs of their areas, and that's the control that the division leaders have within each of the divisions, or the pillar leaders in this case. So that's sort of how it's working. That's sort of the model we're in for 24-25. And as it is basically an incremental budget, as you move into a new fiscal year, unless you've been notified there's going to be major budget cuts because of huge drops in enrollment or potential big cuts in state appropriation, you can expect that budget to start out the new year. And then it would be adjusted if there's new initiatives, if there's additional dollars. And then accordingly, any contractual compensation, obviously, would be automatically adjusted to the departments. So that's a quick overview of trends, overview of our current year budget, and then the process we're in for the future. So probably any questions at this point on that part, because then I got to go into facilities and then into another area.
Anyone?
All right. Hugo's going to ask one here.
No, I was just curious how good a predictor is what the government, when the governor puts out their proposed budget, how close usually is to the final budget. So how good you can take that as a to work on it?
We try to estimate fairly close. Obviously, during a year, your biggest factors are primarily going to be your enrollment and the effect on tuition and fees. And if there's a major difference between what we projected and what's actual, then we would have to take budget action during January if there's a differential.
I meant when the governor in February, when the governor puts out the budget, how close is that to what is going to be finally approved?
Every year it varies, Hugo. I mean, we've had like 2-3% differences between the governor and the final budget, up or down. Even like by the time they get all the way through the cycle, even through the from governor to House to Senate, that number can change drastically between then and them finally passing the budget. In past years, the last 3 or 4 years prior to this year, when the governor passed a budget, we could typically count on it coming 1 or 2% below what the governor's recommendation is. But it varies every year, and it's been very different the last few years, especially with all the other factors like COVID and other things happening. Your history of how it happens keeps changing, and so that's a challenge, obviously. Sorry, I misunderstood the question initially.
Gavin, before you go into the facilities update, and first of all, and this will be kind of the focus of your pillar this year, the facilities projects, but I mean the reason that we led off this university forum with a focus on the budget is because, and this is maybe the number one point of curiosity for folks across campus and maybe even in the community, and rightfully so. I mean, the university runs on our budget. Sometimes that curiosity leads people, and I can count myself as one of them. When I was faculty, for example, you think there's a lot more kind of, no disrespect, Gavin, a lot more excitement and kind of mystery behind the budget process than there really is. I mean, but that's the budget process right there. And there's really a pretty methodical set of steps that the state goes through and that we match in our own processes. As I think you made clear, Gavin, at the end of the day, there's not a lot of unspoken dollars. I mean, whether it's personnel and kind of contractual increases, you know, whether it's, you know, some of the dollars that we need to put into deferred maintenance or just normal operating expenses. Even this year, right? Just by most standards, I would say a landmark year in terms of the state appropriation, enrollment, and FTE and tuition revenue in a really good place. I mean, you're looking at, it was $6.6 million, over half, about half of that immediately spoken for because of personnel costs and a bit more than that also spoken for because of inflationary adjustments. So what you saw there in that one slide you have with the investments and initiatives, those five categories, that's it. You know, that's what ultimately we decided to invest those dollars in. It was about $3.3 million. And you know, as we move into the pillar presentations here and we talk about how the new organization of the university around the student experience, student affairs and success, people, culture, and well-being, academic affairs, finance administration, but the priorities that the university is focusing on, I think, are reflected in those initiatives and investments. And so that's like the magic of the budget process. It's not magical, but it does take a lot of hard work. There are a number of moving pieces. And as we work through these presentations and the budget workshops, we're just gonna kind of dive into those sections one by one so that if you do have more specific questions, we can unpack them. But I really wanna thank you for spending the time just kind of running us through it again, and it won't be the last time. Very happy that we're in a place where we're talking about investments and initiatives and new facilities. Even happy that we're in a place talking about communication rather than in a place where we're talking about some other things we could be discussing with the budget. So if there are more questions, great. If not, Gavin, then yeah, why don't you kick us off? We'll walk through all of the five pillars and just give a brief highlight of what you'll be hearing about this year from each one of the pillar leads.
All right, thank you, Brock. Facilities is a big part of what I've been doing with this last year. Obviously, we've had a lot of projects going on, and we completed up the Jacob Eddy Complex, the Well-Being Center, and the Bear Center, and we have several more to go, and that's obviously it'll keep us busy the next few years, as well as, you know, hopefully we get the capital outlay project too. That would be sort of icing on the cake for everything. If you look first, we have the next step that we're working on is the Hardin Hall renovation. Those bids were out in October. Bids are due in the month of November, and we expect to award in December. Moving out of the top two floors of the library would happen in December, and we'd start construction in January of 2024. That's a two-year construction project. The science complex for research and teaching labs, the project will go out to bid in December. Construction would be awarded in January, and it would actually start in May for construction with the estimated completion of August 2025. Again, there's been a lot of work done on this, on both of these projects already. And there will continue to be, once we start construction, it'll get even more intense over that time period. Vandeman Arena, we awarded the contract for construction, and as volleyball season ends, we'll start construction in December, and we have to complete it by August as volleyball will need it again, starting in September. So, or actually in August, we expect to complete early August so they can have the court at that time. And then finally, one we just completed was the Barry Events Center ice. We had to replace the ice making system, and that was a tight project that got a little dicey towards the end. We were finally able to make ice beginning October 8th, and I think it was a week ago was the first day they were able to skate on it, and then we had games this weekend, so you couldn't cut it much closer than that. But we did get it done, and they did play hockey this weekend, and I'm glad we won that last game. Hopefully it starts the string going forward. And then next up after that, we have the Superior Dome turf replacement. I've already had to replace this once. This will be the second time I have to replace it. This project went out to bid in October. We received a bid, and we're working on finalizing that agreement for the dome turf. We expect to start construction of the turf in summer of 2024 and be done in the fall. So that one will be a tight timeline also, as we have football starting up in the fall. Maybe we'll have an outdoor game or something on the practice fields. I don't know. We'll get it done in time. But again, these are some major projects. Obviously, we at the beginning of this fall, we completed a number of other projects. And we continue to work on the College of Business as our capital outlay. There's still some hope this year, but we need to see where that goes, and we'll continue to work on that one. Questions? Fire away, Hugo.
In all this, talking about finances, mm-hmm. where the foundation fits in, you know, how much the resources from the foundation contributes to the budget or to the projects. I mean, in some universities, they name a building after somebody and then you get a huge amount of money. So how the foundation fits into all this?
I can take a first crack at that. You haven't yet. Well, so the answer to that, and I know Brad is here as well and can probably add, the answer is it depends. And you're right. I mean, certainly along the way you can connect with donors around things like naming rights in a building. We certainly have had a lot of success in having the foundation fund things that are really influential in our budget. Student scholarships, for example, the number is significant. I'm thinking about other examples. I don't know if Rick Comley is here, but over in athletics, some of the facilities improvements in athletics heavily financed through private donors, and the foundation plays a huge role there as well. Annual giving is, a significant part of what we do every year on this campus. So Andy's here, and his crew at the foundation support different priorities. I think there have traditionally been three or four themes that are highlighted, everything from kind of like the food pantry and emergency aid to other priorities. Look, I think we have about 1 year, less than 1 year from now, the public announcement of, or the announcement of our, the public phase of our fundraising campaign. And as part of that, a lot of the big ticket priorities at NMU are gonna be highlighted as giving priorities. And so part of my job, how I'm judged, and how the foundation certainly is judged, is in our ability to secure private support. So some of these projects, the ones that are kind of a bit further out, I hope to have a very significant amount of support from the foundation as part of the budget. Gavin, anything you wanna add, or Brad, anything you wanna add to that?
I guess right on target.
Okay, all right, thanks.
All right, so next up, introduce Dale Kapla to go over academic affairs updates.
Well, thank you, Gavin. Thank you, President Tessman. Thank you all for being here this afternoon. And I'm gonna go over a pillar project, a big project that we've been working on in academic affairs called Campus for All. And I want to tell you a little bit of how we got to this idea. It was Innovation Week this past summer, this past spring. And we attended some sessions regarding accessibility and mobility. And there was a Theater for All session that we went to, and I was fortunate enough to be part of that when former President Schuling was here, part of that initiative. We attended that, and we also attended one out on the island by Bay Cliff Health Camp. And out there, we learned from Claire, who is the executive director, and Jess, who's the camp director, about some barriers to mobility and accessibility in certain buildings, and it wasn't about barriers here on Northern, it was barriers at other places across the community. And Claire said something very profound. She said, wouldn't it be nice to have a campus that was accessible to all persons? And we said, yeah, great. That'd be a great idea. And so myself and Leslie Warren and Abigail Weich, we were all at those sessions, and we said, campus for all. So that's where the idea was born. So where is it and what is it? It has three components. And the first component is our accessibility and barrier efforts here on campus. Been working very closely with Jim Thompson Facilities, Mike Bath in the police department, on what our current inventory is across campus for accessibility, such as the power assist doors, and those types of barrier-free accommodations. What the goal is to get an inventory and then create an interactive map that is publicly available on our website. So when we have potential parents of potential students or potential students get on our website, they can take a look and say, look, we got you. We got you. Here's what we have on campus. We're ADA compliant, of course. We may not be perfect, but at least we're showing you where we're at. And one of the things that it does, it will identify some of the deficiencies that we have. And we know that we have deficiencies that we will continue to work on. One of the things with this first part is I've also engaged the help of students. There's a group on campus called Diversity and Disability. Dana Hinckley runs that. I don't know if Dana is here this afternoon, but I've been to one of their meetings. And they're a great and active group. And much like Bay Cliff with Jess's story and Claire's stories is we need to hear from students and folks that are actually experiencing this across campus. So we have engaged them, and I'm going to use them as a sounding board as we move forward with that. I'm also talking with a student by the name of Carrie Rogers, who's part of that group. And I have a couple phone calls with her already, and she has been very helpful in some of the things that she is needing across campus that we don't necessarily have yet, but we're getting there. So that's really the first phase. And of course, with this interactive map, we're also going to have other things in terms of like where the AEDs are located. We're going to be working on digital accessibility on our website and different things that we record and put out to the public. And we're going to come up with a prioritization list of what things do we want to tackle first. One of the other components that we have is program and neurodiversity, and we're just starting to work on this now. What does that mean? And these programs for neurodiversity stem anywhere from just sort of peer support groups to really full-fledged programs that are fee-based for students. And we're going to take a look at several of these that are already in place across other universities across the country and across the world. We're going to figure out which one is best for Northern. For instance, what do one of these programs or what is one of the, the activities that students would do, what are they? Well, really, they're designed to support mentally ill and neurodivergent students throughout their whole educational process right through to graduation. They're also to provide culturally and socially responsible peer support services, which is something I know that we can do here. And it's also to create peer-led spaces for communal support and collective healing. One of the things that we're going to work on, and we're doing a lot of work with our counselors in our counseling center, is we're also going to be able to connect individuals to culturally and socially responsive mental health care services. So really, in a nutshell, that is really what the second component is the program for neurodiversity. So there's more to come on that. And then finally, a component that we have been working on over in the CTL, which is Universal Design for Learning, which is UDL, CTL, of course, includes faculty. Matt Smock and his area over there have been doing a fantastic job. And what is that? Well, UDL is an inclusive practice that gives students options for how they learn and demonstrate their learning. For instance, the program Ally. You may have heard of that, and you're online, and there's a PDF that can be read to you. It's a reader that can be read to students. And so we're also working on professional closed captioning for just about everything that we do. And one of the stages that they're moving in over in the CTL is they're moving more towards looking towards faculty and our D&I efforts. The challenge faculty and say, what other things do you think are barriers? What other things do you hear of in the classroom that we need to work on? So that's coming. And so in the coming months, we're going to be rolling out a lot of this, and it's certainly not designed to replace anything we're currently doing with disability services. It's designed to enhance that. And so if you have any ideas along the way, please let me know. You can let Leslie Warren know. You can let Abigail Weitch know. And we'll be updating you regularly on that. So thank you. Questions? You go.
Questions for Dale and the Campus for All project.
Okay.
Stephanie.
Hey, okay, sorry about my voice.
It's okay.
But on the interactive map, will you be including our gender-neutral restrooms across campus?
We can, certainly. That see, there's really the great. Ideas exactly. Yes, yes, we will.
Thanks.
Yes, and Mike's here and Jim's here too, certainly. Thank you for that, Stephanie. Mm-hmm. Anything else?
Good. Okay. Thanks very much, Dale.
Okay, you're welcome. Welcome. Jeff.
Good afternoon. Just looking out in the audience here, and I think we got to take a chance to acknowledge we have two student leaders with us today, unless there are other students that I don't see. But we have Marla and Rosa here, who are presidents of two of our big student organizations on campus, Black Student Union and Latinx Student Union. So thank you for being here with us today. Here to talk to you about a pillar project we're working on and really has to do with commuter students. We have a lot of different aspects to our pillar that we have projects in, but this is one of those projects that touches all aspects of our pillar, and I want to highlight some of those things that working on a commuter student project touches. But first, before I do that, how many former commuter students do we have in this audience? Of our college grads, how many folks commuted to college? Okay. And then how many were local commuter students? So how many were from the Marquette, Ishpeming, Nagani, Gwynn? Okay, good. That's like a quarter of the room right there. So you'll know how this feels. I too was a commuter student, and I'll touch on that in a moment. But this is a topic that touches all aspects of our pillar, from recruitment and how we have the opportunity to engage with our local and commuter students before they're not only ever applied, I mean, but from the time they're in elementary school and middle school and work through high school, and how we orientate those applied and admitted students to Northern, how we, once they're here, how we engage them in student organizations and events and activities, athletics, programming, how we can engage them in summer opportunities as they grow up, not only while they're in middle school and high school, but certainly while they're here. How can we engage commuter students in leadership programs and leadership opportunities that they might get the chance to stay here in the summer for? And even housing, we have some real lessons that I think we can take from housing and the way in which we build community with our resident population and how we can apply that to our commuter student base. So a little bit about our commuter students. Commuter students make up about 60% of our student population. And of that, about 20% are what you kind of identify as a true commuter student. So from the Marquette, Ishpeming, Nagani, Gwynn area, somewhere within a 60-mile radius of campus where they graduated high school. And we know commuter students have like unique challenges that our resident populations don't have. Think of the things they might have grown up hearing throughout the years about Marquette or Northern, and that wanting to stay when they have friends that are going maybe downstate or are going, you know, traveling out of the region to go to college. There's just that, well, just going to NMU, right? I don't mean that. I'm just saying that's a this perception. You might have folks who have just this idea of, I'm going to go to Northern, I'm going to take a few classes, and I'm going to transfer on and get out of here. I want to get away from home. And you have folks who, because we're affordable, because we're close, they may not have other options. And so they kind of have this feeling like, well, maybe I'm just stuck going to Northern. And that's something we certainly, I think we've worked a long time to try to change, but we want to focus an intentional effort on how we can get at that. And a couple of challenges I faced as a commuter student, just a touch about my background. I moved up here from San Antonio, Texas. I live with my grandmother in Ishpeming. So I was a little unique in that. But I had the challenge of not feeling connected right away. I went to orientation. There's this gap between orientation and first day. And I got here the first day, and I didn't know how to connect. I didn't know how to get along with folks. I didn't know what made Northern tick. You also have the challenge of I drive to class from Ishpeming. I'd have 3 hours between my next class. I'd drive home. And it started to be, especially as winter hit and being a native Texan, I just might not drive back for that next class, or I might miss more classes because you kind of get in this thing of going home, and we have some ways to, we think we can get at that. So commuter students, like we can all acknowledge, have their own unique set of challenges. So as we start this work, so much of the work that we have to do with commuter students really begins before they're ever here. It begins in providing, I think, opportunities for local students to engage in Northern in new ways. One of the biggest ways they can do that is how we're planning on increasing our summer opportunities, whether they be academic, social, recreational, athletic, providing more of those opportunities for our local students to engage with us, hopefully in some type of a live-on experience, so they can feel that, that campus and the culture, and feel that vibe growing up. There's a school 120 miles to my back that does that really well. And just like we're going to do in volleyball tomorrow night, this is an area we want to wipe the floor with them in, and providing opportunities to. Thank you. Yeah. Providing opportunities for those folks to engage. There's the programming too. It's not just summer. There's programming that we think we can create, especially as we get into the winter months, to get those students to come on campus. I'm really thinking about like our juniors and seniors in high school, to come here, to give them something special. Maybe looking at events at the Thomas Theater, so that we have commuter night at the Thomas Theater, and we can start to build community with our local students before they're even ever students. Want to think about the way, once they're applied and enrolled, how we can orientate our commuter students a little differently to help them feel more of a community and more engaged. And when they're here, I think we really have the opportunity to take some lessons from housing. We have selfishly I can say this, but Kat and her team of resident directors and RAs have a real intentional method in how they build community. And it starts with relationships. It starts with helping students connect to each other and connect to faculty and staff and connect to parts of campus. And it's providing opportunities for involvement and engagement. And what we want to do is take that same method and apply it to where we already know commuter students hang out. We know they hang out in Hardin Hall. We know they hang out in lounges in Jamrich. We know they hang out in this building. We know Jacob Betty is a hotbed of commuter students. And as we've developed that new lounge, how can we get in that space and start to help them build connections with each other? How can we create opportunities for them to stay between classes and start engaging with them in that way, so that they can, again, it's all about building this connection, giving them something to do. I really think this is gonna be a game changer in the way we can strengthen our campus culture. We have two sides of campus right now. We have our resident students and we have our commuter students. And if we can build community in our commuter students and work to connect these two sides of campus together, to get them working together, I think that's going to just lead to more engagement, more meaningful opportunities for involvement, and help people feel like they're really part of something. And I think that's so important for our local students to feel like they're part of something. And in the end, our pillar is really engaged in the work of creating an increased sense of sense of belonging on campus. And so our work, as we work day in, day out with commuter students, there really will be this focus on how do we help them find their true authentic self and be that true authentic self as they continue on their experience here. So, couple of notes. It wasn't us. It was a student who came to us last spring that wanted to start a commuter student organization. They've started that organization. They've officially registered 2 or 3 weeks ago. We have now 6 members of our commuter student organization that are up and going. This effort is largely being led by Nicole Shoup, who's our director of orientation. So a good portion of her time is helping to provide help to that student organization and really all of our efforts with commuters. And then we're looking from help from staff and faculty and certainly other students to form a team that can help with some of the challenges here. And so if you're interested in that, please reach out to me, please reach out to Nicole. We want to get in touch with you and meet and talk about some of the things that you think we can do in your spaces or with your students to help our commuter students get by. So, any questions? Nothing? All right, yeah, Candace. I think Derek's walking over a mic, so everyone can hear you, sorry. Yeah.
I promise I won't start singing. I think the biggest thing is to find a way for commuter students to, just locate or have a location mm-hmm. and bridge the gap between classes, because they may not necessarily want to go to the library. They may not necessarily have enough money to go to the coffee shop, but they want to feel included, and just feel that engagement and that sense of happiness in between classes. Like, I'm not lost here.
Right. Right. No, I think you're absolutely right. I don't know if there's ever going to be one central place for all that to happen, and that's why we're really taking the approach of wherever they land, we want to be in that space. We want to make sure we're making a real intentional effort to be in that space, and they know where to find our staff or other staff. So it's connecting with them on their turf, I think, is the most important. Yeah. Other questions? Yeah.
So I was wondering how graduate students factor into this. I have 2 questions, but that was the first one.
Yeah, I mean, I think they absolutely factor into it. I think we can look, as we build this out, at looking at, a particular working with that particular subset, but they're sitting in lounges, they're sitting all over campus, and as we engage with them and we get to hear their feedback, we're gonna address the things that graduate students might tell us, absolutely.
The second is more of a nuanced data question. I'm sorry, it's as loud as I can go.
That's all right.
Of that I think you said 60% of our students are commuter mm-hmm. students, and about 20% are local, so true commuter.
Right.
But those other 40%, have we noticed that they've been living further away as the cost of housing increases? And does that affect your plan?
Yeah, no, that's a really good one. I'm glad you brought that up. Most of what I've mentioned really focuses on those local students. Those 40%, though, that are, kind of matriculated out of our housing program after a couple of years and are out there in the community are going further and further away. So I think it's important as we think of how we're going to connect with high school students in the Ishpeming-Nagani-Gwin area, how are we going to connect with our commuters out there too? And some of that is just as we think of programs and events and services, maybe not waiting for them to come here, but going to them with certain things. And that's something Brock and I have talked about a little bit on how we can hold events on the West End, events out in Gwin, so that we can connect with those folks. In terms of, I'll stop there. But that's certainly on our mind as we go forward with this. Yeah. Yeah.
Hey Jeff, as a commuter student from West Ishpeming, it was suggested to me from some upperclassmen that I got to meet on campus, why don't you buy a 5 meal plan? That way, I could pick from my lunch mm-hmm. if it was convenient. I didn't have to travel back to West Ishpeming to get dinner, come back for a night mm-hmm. class, so to speak. So that also puts you in the dining area
right.
to meet all of these other students that I really had a good experience and met a lot of other students doing that.
Right. I agree. Food is one of our biggest connectors in housing. Like, all of our students who live in housing all eat. And if we can connect with them at the dinner table, that's the good thing. I just saw Tom nod his head, and he said he's willing to provide all commuters a meal plan. So thank you. Thank you, Tom. Okay, all right. Yeah, but I agree. It's a really good point. That's something we'll take note of. Thank you. Other questions? Yeah. Mr. Truckee.
While they're fighting with the microphone.
Yeah.
Is it me?
I think Rosie said, yeah.
Oh, go ahead.
Oh, okay. I was going to agree with whoever said it over there about the food. A lot of people in LSU live like between 5 to 10 minutes away, and I know that's not a long drive. I mean, I'm 5 minutes away from the school, but I do think that like food is definitely something. Not all of our members can afford like $10 to $12 for a meal, and especially because like sometimes you have to buy things separately. I think that, you know, there are some good meal plans, but not everyone can afford them. So maybe, you know, something along those lines. And parking, I'm sorry, but parking for the commuters sometimes makes it a little bit harder as well. I know that there has been changes in some of the parking lots and what parking lots are resident and what parking lots are commuter, but sometimes ours are a little bit further away. Sure. So that can also do something with it. I'm not sure. But
no,
yeah.
That's really good feedback. And as I think that commuter student org develops, I think they'll have an avenue to provide some of that feedback and some real testimony as to some of those challenges. Living 5 or 10 minutes away isn't as easy as it sounds, especially for our folks who are local. You drive back home, you get sucked into maybe childcare for a brother or sister. You might get drawn into some family drama while you think you're just going home and you can come back later for class. It's not as easy as it sounds living just 5 or 10 minutes away.
Yeah. Thank you. Well, in all this talk about, you know, the countywide, especially going west, transportation, I think, is something that really needs to be addressed, and it's certainly not something that Northern alone can address. It's
right.
It's a community-wide question, you know, such as an express bus, Northern express bus from Ishpeming to Marquette every day, maybe 2 or 3 times a day, taking away some of those barriers of people having to commute by themselves in their car. That helps with parking. And dare I dream, light rail from Ishpeming to Marquette.
I like it.
You know, I mean, what an idea. And I don't want to leave Gwynn out, but, you know.
Right.
I just think that we need to start thinking broader about transportation in the county because the population demographics are starting to move up the hill more.
Right.
And that's a good thing. I think it's good for everybody, and we just need to start thinking it is just not just Marquette, but Marquette County and the 41 corridor especially, so.
Yeah. As we had we met with the enrollment committee this morning, and that was what we closed with, is the transportation piece for those folks who are forced to move out and out and out. And that, rather than, could we ever build an apartment complex in Ishpeming? Probably not. Probably not. But we can help to find ways and suggestions to improve the transportation. So thank you for that.
I know times have changed dramatically, but, you know, when I was a commuter student, we used to pick up 5 people. Students from Ishpeming before we would head to Marquette. And you didn't leave until the end of the day when everybody was done with their classes. And one of our favorite places was above the library where we would play smear and, you know, stuff like that waiting for the end of the day.
Yeah.
But I do think that, you know, summer programs for commuter students with maybe a live-on campus experience to show them that, you know, just because you're a commuter student doesn't mean you can't get involved in these types of things, the facilities, the groups, the activities, you know, to just show them that, like I said, just because you're a commuter student doesn't mean you can't be involved in these kinds of activities. And, you know, I know how excited kids are when they come in for orientation and then it's just like, oh, that was it?
Yeah.
You know, all I have to look forward to now is driving in every day and not feeling connected, you know, sitting in some study area for 2 to 3 hours feeling completely disconnected.
Right.
So yeah, I think this is a wonderful initiative.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you. All good points. I appreciate that. I think I'm at time. So if you'd like to chat more, I'll be here after. And thank you for the feedback. Thank you for the questions.
Thanks, Jeff. And actually, thanks to Dale and Jeff. I heard you guys mention, can everyone hear me? All right. A number of times, culture building, community building, accessibility. These are all really critical issues that we talk about all the time as well in people, culture, and well-being. So you sort of see that working across, which is really great to see. All right. So I wanted to start by orienting you a little bit to when we talk about people, culture, and well-being, what are we talking about in terms of the makeup of the team? Because it's been a while, I think, since we sort of put out there who these folks are and the teams that are doing this really critical work across campus. So just a reminder that it is the Diversity and Inclusion Office. It is our Equal Opportunity and Title IX Office. Human resources, as well as well-being. And some folks know that when we talk about the pillar, I actually refer to us more as like an energy field. Because I sort of feel like, you know, the work that we do is really connected to one another. And it's also really connected across the other division and pillars in terms of how we best support faculty, staff, and students. So, you know, when you're talking about equal opportunity, you're also having conversations about how do we make our search processes more inclusive? How are we more thoughtful about casting a wider net from a diversity perspective? When we talk about diversity and inclusion, we are always talking about the mental health components and well-being, and really how critical those pieces are to the success of our students, as well as to the success of our faculty and staff. And when we talk about well-being, especially as it relates to our employees, we need to be really thoughtful about the kinds of programs, plans, policies we put into place as it relates to how we're supporting people from a health and wellness perspective, a financial perspective, work-life resources, all of those things. So they're all really critical and certainly all connected. The other thing I wanted to reference on this slide is the numbers underneath the titles of these departments notes the number of full-time staff we have actually working in those groups. And I had to take a moment to acknowledge the incredibly hard work being done by a handful of people in this space. Stephanie Vargas, the full-time staff of One, obviously supported in amazing ways by her graduate and undergraduate students in the Office of Diversity and Inclusion. And I always refer to Jill now as the amazing Jill Compton, who, in addition to her daytime job, has overseen both Diversity and Inclusion and the International Programs Office for well over a year. But one full-time staff, and obviously amazing work that continues to come out of that department. So thank you, Stephanie. Well-being, too. We will be three soon, so we're very excited about that. In the Human Resources Department, 5 FTE dedicated to HR, and then 3 over in Equal Opportunity and Title IX, which that work is also all-consuming. So I wanted to say a thank you to that crew. You are small and you are mighty, and you are doing really, really important work on campus, so thank you for that. So I'm gonna talk a little bit about our pillar project in the People, Culture, and Wellbeing pillar, and then I'm gonna ask Jill to come up and talk a little bit about some of the really great work that's been happening in diversity and inclusion as well. So to start, this project is actually something that I've been wanting to focus on for a long time, and was very thankful that after having some conversations with staff members and Brock, sort of gave us some runway to really put some dedicated effort behind this, and this is a staff development program. So the focus here really from a goal perspective is to formalize a staff development program that really supports the ongoing learning and growth opportunities for NMU staff. So what does that mean? Well, what we're planning to do from a fundamental standpoint is make sure that that program continues to connect to our values. We don't always talk about our core values, but I'm one of those freaks that continues to sort of bring this out every once in a while. We do it in all the training programs that we do that come out of HR. We also are obviously tie our values to our performance management process on the staff side. So we want to be really thoughtful that what we're building is mindful of the core values. We do think that things like community, opportunity, inclusion, environment continue to be critical, and we want to make sure that those are embedded in this program. Also, we want to make sure that it's built on a foundation of well-being, diversity and inclusion, as well as service. And when we talk about service, we're talking about both on-campus service opportunities as well as how we acknowledge and support off-campus community service in a more formalized way. And then we want to make sure that this program is embedded in our culture in a way that it's sustainable over time. So I think it's really great and really cool that we're talking about staff professional development now, and we're going to talk about it next month, and we're going to talk about it 6 months from now. But I want to make sure we're still talking about it 10 years from now, 20 years from now. And so in order for us to do that, we need to be really thoughtful about what it is we're building and how we make sure that it's really embedded in our culture. So we actually have been working very closely. Renee Sheen, who is our Associate Director for Employee Experience, and I have been working very closely with Andy Hill, other members of the AP unit from a leadership standpoint, as well as the AFSCME leadership, TOP leadership. I don't know if Tyler is here. We've been getting together biweekly to talk about professional development and really what we think this should look like in order for it to be meaningful. We put together a survey that went out earlier this summer to about a little over 500 staff employees, both on the represented and non-represented side, and we had over a 30% survey return, which we think demonstrated there's just a lot of passion in the space, so we were very excited to see so much interest. And there was a lot of data, a lot of really great data, and some of the key takeaways from that particular survey, number one told us that people's onboarding experience, that sort of entry point into Northern, is really, really critical in terms of how they feel about NMU and how connected they feel to the institution, right? Which makes sense. Research tells us that about students. We were just talking about that, Jeff. And it certainly holds true when we talk about employees. If people don't feel that sense of connection, they don't stay. At least they don't stay as long as you'd want them to. So that piece is really important. And one of the challenges that we have on the staff side, obviously, is that our sort of onboarding experience is completely decentralized. Unlike faculty and academic affairs, you've got folks coming on at all times during the course of the year, right, into very different positions under very different management in very different departments. So it's difficult to find commonality in terms of how do we bring people together to have a common experience that really connects them to the institution. But we'll talk a little bit more about, you know, some of the things that we're looking to do to address that. One of the other things we found is that people really feel that they have limited access to both on-campus and off-campus development experiences. Part of this is a budget issue, honestly, because there are not dollars set aside for staff development. So people, particularly in smaller departments, are really fighting for that opportunity with, you know, whether or not one-time dollars are going to be used to fund something else that might be needed, like fixing something or something. Anyway, the dollars aren't there. So that's tough, right? Because sometimes the professional development experiences that we want to have cost money. And sometimes the dollars aren't there, so that can be frustrating. And what we also know from people and we heard on the survey is time is also a challenge. spending even a few hours away from the office to get some kind of development experience is often challenging for people, so we know that's also a barrier that we have to be thoughtful about. But we also learned is there's definitely a strong interest in building stronger technical as well as career-specific skills and knowledge, as well as leadership and interpersonal skills, really across the board from an employee group standpoint. So we have that to build on, which is really helpful. So with that said, what are we working on? And as I mentioned, we're still working with this advisory group of employees that are giving us some really great suggestions on how to really bring that data to life in terms of a way forward. So the first thing that we're working on, well, actually, I shouldn't say first thing, because these are all sort of workflows that are happening at the same time. The first one is building out a more robust staff onboarding process. So the cool thing in PageUp is that we already are doing some of this work because we can leverage the onboarding portal to help both our new hires as well as our managers kind of give them nudges in terms of the kinds of things that they could be doing and should be doing to build that sense of connection, right? And those are common things, in some ways, common things to NMU, and there might be some career-specific things related to the department, but that's technology that we hope to leverage even more in terms of building that out and making it more robust. We're also thinking about how HR, as well as IT, and the controller's office, which are fundamental pieces across some of the onboarding experiences that some of our office-based personnel have, how we can maybe do a better job of ensuring there's common experience in terms of interaction with those groups. And we're also talking about launching for the first time a staff orientation program. So that's going to happen in January, and I'm going to say it's going to happen because we actually have a date, we have a location, and we actually have people who've committed to helping us build this out, which is awesome. So we are going to talk about mission, vision, values. Thanks to Dan Truckee, who I think is going to join us to talk about. You probably didn't know this yet, Dan. Thanks, Dan. Dan's going to come and share, you know, his knowledge around some NMU historical experiences. We're going to have students come and chat with the group. And it's a great way, again, to build community because you're talking about a group of people who are unlike one another in terms of their background and experience and the work that they do and whether they're working from 7 to 3 or, you know, in the evening. So that'll be one thing that we're looking forward to actually in January. And then the group actually has come up with a really cool idea of building a cadre of employees across these employee groups that can serve as, in some way, mentors, but really supports. So as people are coming into Northern, they can come up that onboarding curve a little bit sooner just by having someone reach out to them and talk them through how they navigate within Northern, how to connect them to the things that they found helpful. And we're talking about that, like I said, really across those groups right now in terms of how do you identify those individuals, how do we best support them so that they can do that work, in addition, obviously, to the work that they do in their day-to-day responsibilities. We're going to look to build professional development maps. So after you go through that onboarding experience, obviously, and you're going through your career here at NMU, there's a difference between what you might need early in your career versus mid-career versus later in your career. We want to think about, you know, acknowledging that in a meaningful way and being thoughtful about how we build out a map that allows people to have a long runway here at NMU. That really is the goal. We are talking about branding and formalizing that program in some way. Remember, I talked about the importance of ensuring that this is something that lives on, right? That we're actually not just talking about this today or next year, but that we continue to support this effort, you know, 15, 20 years down the road. So we'd like to acknowledge, as people are moving through these experiences, that they're getting some level of badging that goes along with it, that there are milestone achievement experiences that people can achieve by having certain well-being, diversity and inclusion, professional development, and community service activities actually completed. And the group is helping us think through, you know, what that might look like. And then finally, we are piloting a staff professional development day. The really cool thing about this is that our content is already built because we got really great feedback from a survey standpoint on really what those priorities should be in terms of what employees need. We are validating that with managers as well, just to make sure that there's alignment between what employees believe they need and what managers feel that they need as well. And the intent is to create something that hopefully from a format and content standpoint is relevant enough across all the different employee groups, because as I mentioned, these are people doing very different work, that they will find some commonality in the things that are really meaningful to them, that really support them. And again, with an eye to the D&I and well-being experiences, well-being in terms of caring for self as well as supporting others that we're hoping to include in that experience for the Staff Professional Development Day. That is also slated for the spring. We don't have a date yet, but we're working towards that. So that's the pilot project or the pillar project, Staff Professional Development. I don't know if you have any questions. I'm happy to chat about it. Emily?
I actually don't have a question, but I really appreciate it. One thing I think about is a lot of areas, and I don't know, maybe it's just me that thinks there are a lot of areas with part-time employees, and having some wayfinding for them as well would be really useful, because they'll get sent to an office and then they'll be like, what are you doing here? You're not really in the system, you know? And so just somehow understanding a wayfinding for them as well, because we rely on them a lot.
Are you talking temp labor?
Temp labor.
Okay, got it.
Yeah, because there's sometimes temp labor that actually become really regular part-time people that sort of get lost in the mix. And then secondly, I'm always happy to assist with any sort of orientation sorts of things with the museum as well.
We've written your name down, and I've underlined it. Thank you. Very helpful. Yeah, I am, and hats off to Kathy Frazier, who very quickly offered up most of the people in the controller's office to spend time with folks who we know are typically, I mean, it's difficult to get up and running when you're working in the office environment and you really don't know how Concur or Cognos and other things like that function. Thank you, Kathy, because she's been very thoughtful about thinking about the employees that can really help to support that work quickly. Yeah, Kevin.
Well, I was just going to agree. I know the onboarding process, because, you know, especially on the staff side, is, you know, each department is different. So I like that you're thinking about that. But also, a lot of us have student employees as well. I know I kind of mentioned this once. I think down the line would be kind of cool to have some kind of onboarding process for them. I actually found a great program that I kind of stole from GBSU. It has modules that our students are doing that talk about communications, ethics in the workplace, team building, and that's something I kind of trained our students is, you know, yeah, you might not work in the foundation. I mean, granted, all of us that work in the foundation never thought we went to school to work here, but I want to prepare them to, like, be in the real world and workforce or trying to use those skills now to help them down the line, so I think that could be built into that, too.
Yeah, it's a great idea, Kevin. In fact, when we talk about best practices related to student employment, I mean, I think that's one of the things that we're focused on for Professional Development Day is supervising employees. I think that'll be a really nice opportunity to share exactly those kinds of best practices, so thank you. Yeah. Yes, Brad.
I like to see you have the formal development in the badging, trying to make faculty and staff kind of be recognized. We tried that with the faculty and the online teaching fellows. So I see a lot of faculty putting that badge on their email signatures. I think it's a way for people to, whether it's internally or externally, to kind of show that they're doing something and they're professional and they're kind of expanding their knowledge and while they're working. So if you need help in the badging, feel free to.
Oh my gosh, this is great. I really wasn't expecting to get volunteers today, but this is awesome. So thank you, Brad. And when you think about it, if you're looking to be promoted or potentially to be considered for other opportunities at NMU, I see Brock is looking at his watch. I'm going to, like, wrap this up really quick. The thing, I guess, to keep in mind, too, is that those badging opportunities actually allow you to demonstrate to a potential manager who's or a hiring manager the skills that you've developed since being here at Northern, right? And there's a lot. But sometimes we have a hard time articulating those things on a resume, so a badge really helps you from that standpoint too. Thank you. All right, I'm gonna, and again, I'll offer like Jeff did, happy to stick around and have more conversations about this because I have a lot of passion in this space and I can tell that there's a lot of interest here, so thank you for that. And I'm gonna go ahead and introduce the amazing Jill Compton to come to the stage.
The amazing Jill Compton doesn't speak in public very often, so here we go. Should be a slide change here. Page down?
Yep, you got it.
Okay, so a few things we want to talk about diversity and inclusion. First of all, I'm sure you're all anxious to hear about how the search for a new assistant vice president for diversity and inclusion is going. I have a fantastic co-chair, Dr. Amy Hamilton, and help from Terry Williams and a big, great crew on a search committee who are helping us move forward with that. And I wanna thank the campus too, to everyone who participated into the listening sessions from AGB Search. They really helped our committee focus and decide what's important to campus in hiring this new leader, this new very important campus leader. The timeline is chugging right along. This last weekend was the deadline for turning in applications. The full committee will meet on Friday to decide who we want to interview by Zoom. We plan to bring candidates to campus, our final candidates to campus, the week of November 27th, and have a recommendation to Dr. Tessman by December 4th. Hopefully starting a new assistant vice president position in January next semester. And boy, do we have some things that we want to do with this new person, and we're really excited. While we wait for a new AVP, student programming must go on. And here I want to also thank Stephanie Vargas for her tremendous work in the diversity office. She has some good support with her graduate assistants and the students there, but as I talk about the things from here on out, we're really talking about Stephanie and her work. So first, NMU has been awarded, I know Gavin's talking in millions of dollars, but we were very excited about NMU being awarded a competitive grant for approximately $100,000 every year for the next 6 years. That grant, that KCP grant, will help us contribute to student success and belonging, and we have a plan to use the money to support student programming, expand the Diversity Office snack pantry, and some other cool initiatives. So we're very excited about that and very proud. Next, I want to talk about the Heritage Calendar. So earlier this year, the Diversity Office received approval for and posted on our website a calendar that helps us align our student programming more closely to national and state heritage and identity recognition. So this is one of the ways that we're able to focus our resources on the timing of programming, student programming, and help students focus the things they want to do and put them into time periods in the calendar that make sense for what they want to do. October, we celebrated Hispanic Heritage, actually September and October because it's a split month, and Indigenous Peoples Day. November celebrates Native American Heritage Month and includes a Transgender Awareness Week. You can access the Heritage Calendar through the Diversity Office web pages, and I encourage you all to take a look at that so that we as a campus can align our programming with this important Heritage Calendar. Next, let's talk about the United Conference. So we have a date. March 21st. The theme has, we don't have fancy catchphrase for it yet, but it will be something about the intersection of well-being and diversity and inclusion. And for the second year in a row, we're going to work very closely with the Diversity Common Reader Program. Last year, we combined the keynote speaker for the Diversity Common Reader Program with the United Conference, and we'll do that again this year. We're very excited. The book that's chosen is What My Bones Know by Stephanie Fu, and it's about generational trauma and complex post-traumatic stress. And we're very close to signing a contract to bringing author Stephanie Fu to campus to be our keynote speaker at the United Conference. Next, diversity is upping our game, upping our D&I game with athletics. So through a series of meetings last year and this year, we have a new game plan for the diversity efforts on the athletic campus. At least one game in every sport will now be dedicated to celebrating LGBTQ+, and one game will be dedicated to celebrating our racial and cultural diversity on campus. We're calling them our Pride pop-ups and Unity pop-ups, and when you attend those games, and again, the schedule is listed on the diversity calendar, as well as some other places, you'll see some special programming, a lot of swag thrown up into the crowds, and some messaging at tables staffed by the diversity office staff. So really excited about that. There are a lot of people who participated in the planning of that, but this year, Rick Comley, Robin Burke, and Dana Rudden really worked closely with the diversity office to make it happen. So we want to thank them for helping the diversity office really execute their plan. In addition to that, the efforts in the athletic office, the diversity office is working on Fridays in the Dome, they call it Diversity in the Dome, to have closer contact with athletes and coaches. They meet with athletes and coaches right over there, and also check out the Diversity Office website. There's new resources for athletes and a really cool new series of blog posts written by our athletes and posted on the Diversity website. And changes in the office. So Gear Up is moving. So the wonderful Joe Lubig has agreed to take on, I'm going to read this because it's a complex acronym, Gaining Early Awareness and Readiness for Undergrad Programs. That's what Gear Up stands for. And the program really reaches out to middle school and high school students, so it's a much better fit to have this program, this big grant with Joe Lubig. We're really excited that the School of Education, Leadership, and Public Service will take on the work of that grant. So thank you to Joe Lubig for that. And that's it. Any questions? How does Stephanie do all this? Okay, thank you.
Okay, I'll be speeding through this, because I just looked at my watch. Okay, so our big project in student affairs and student success is implementation of the new student success advising program. So we started working on this in May. It entailed moving ACAC and embedded advising into a new organizational structure, which we're calling success advising. All students now, from entry to graduation, are served by success advisors. This is not, as most of you probably understand, this is not just about choosing courses for the next semester, okay? This is about building relationships so that the advisors can help the students with any concerns or problems that they may be having. For instance, financial issues, academic issues, mental health issues, majors, careers, food and housing insecurity, roommate issues, and of course, course selection. They still do that. And then they have an effective means to hand off a student to both on-campus and community resources. So I wanted to show you, So these are the eight clusters. This is the way that we have assigned advisors. So it's not just two colleges. We came up with these clusters, ran it by the department heads and faculty, and they are related clusters, so related majors in the clusters, similar curricula, and institutional effectiveness told us where students move most often, and so we put those majors together. This has nothing to do with realignment within colleges, okay? We're not realigning a thing. It is just totally about advising. So the one thing I wanted to point out is that economics has not moved yet to business, math, and computing. They will move as soon as we have staffing in place. All of the advisors have offices in or close to the departments that they serve, and the exploring and non-degree cluster works out of the Student Success Office in Hedgecock, the former ACAC space. Okay, so by November, but I have to qualify now because I just had a meeting this morning, November and early December, okay? All but two clusters will have multiple success advisors. We have received feedback from department heads and students, and it has been very positive. An example of the positive feedback that we've received. A department head told us that his faculty are able to do more effective mentoring now that they are freed up from advising at this time of the semester. This is a crazy time for faculty. They are getting more students involved in research, and more students than ever are getting accepted to present at conferences. So that's a very big deal. So we talked about increasing capacity for faculty mentoring when we set up the new advising model in 2019. That was one of the goals of the retention initiatives, was to allow faculty to do more mentoring. So we're seeing that happening now, which is really good for our students. That's what we want to happen. Advising effectiveness survey of students just started up again. As of last Wednesday, we had 60 responses, overwhelmingly positive. And Neil will be seeking more feedback from department heads and faculty in the near future. Now, how will we know it's a success? This is very important. Overall increase in persistence, retention, and completion rates, increased placement rates 1 year post-graduation, overall student satisfaction rating of 75%, and we're doing that across the whole pillar, but it will certainly be in advising. And we want to begin closing the achievement gaps for first-generation Pell-eligible and domestic diverse students. So that's how we'll know that this project is working. That was fast. Any questions? That means it's late or I was very good. Probably late. Okay, Gavin's coming back up to talk about this. I was determined he would have time to talk.
All right, more exciting topics. this one's a big topic, though, on campus, because what you're seeing across the nation is a lot of security breaches, and there's a big one at U of M to start the school year, which shut them down for a while, and so, you know, it's an ever-evolving process, cybersecurity and protecting your networks. It's constantly changing, and all of us are having to constantly change the way we're protecting the networks. What we did, I put together here a number of ways that we attack this and some of the things that we're doing recently. First one there is zero trust policy. And in the old days, if you were inside the network, we trusted you. I mean, we trusted that you were a valid user. We didn't really have to worry about you too much. We were always looking to the external actors that were trying to get in our networks and focusing the attention there. But with, you know, all the phishing and other attempts going on, your risks were just as big inside the network because it may not be you that's actually using the network, and maybe somebody using your ID or password to get into it. And so our approach had to change from worrying about external to worrying about everyone. And so we call it a zero trust policy in addressing that. One of the things we do to make sure that the network's protected in that regard is we include the enforcement of multi-factor authentication, which many people don't like, but that is one of the processes. It's also a requirement of our insurance carriers that that allow us to have protection from cyber breaches. So while many people don't like it, it is something that we need to do, and it does help in the long run protect our networks. We also run quarterly our own phishing attempts at users on campus, and So if you haven't had to take a education session on what phishing is, that means you passed your test or you haven't been tested. So that's something that we do just to see and so people can understand that, you know, they're trying newer and better ways to get at you to get your information, and we're just trying to make you aware of it. And if that happens, we try to educate you. So that's been a big thing that we've been working on. The other thing we've done is we really enhanced our firewall capabilities, both within and outside of campus. And we moved from one firewall at the border of our campus to having five firewalls covering strategic points across the campus as well as within the campus. What they are called, and John Mara is here to help me get through that part, is they're called level 7 protection. They're deep packet inspection systems that allow for continuous monitoring with the ability to detect and block attacks from within and outside the campus network. And so that's been a big expanded use on our campus. And, you know, it's really there for everybody's protection that's in this room as well as our students. Another big area we did is we look at partnering with other universities in the state, because universities over the last couple years, we've been warned that have become a bigger target for these types of attacks. And while you heard about U of M, there's several other campuses that were also hit within the state. And across the nation, there's more and more. And so we looked at partnering with them to really buy the best tools that are possible out there. And then you have a joint purchasing arrangement. And we call that a runtime. And we have 7 other public universities that are part of this. And what we used it for is to buy services from Palo Alto for all our firewalls. It results in both a discount for NMU as well as it provides NMU additional services we probably wouldn't be able to afford if we were buying it on our own. What this does is NMU gets entitled to cyber risk, cybersecurity, and emergency incident response services from this company. They have world-renowned threat researchers, an elite team of security consultants that create an intelligence-driven, response-ready action on any type of breach that occurs. And obviously, they're out there to protect the breach so it doesn't occur, but should something happen, they're on the spot, they're available 24/7, and they're working with us to resolve any issue that happens. Next thing we've done, it's an endpoint detection and response system, and this is really taking antivirus software to another level. You know, everybody's used to having Norton antivirus and all these others. This one, it's a newer system. It's a next level of protection. It's driven by AI and machine learning language infrastructure, and it's more effective at detecting new threats and suspicious client behavior in real time and containing those events. It also leverages connection to the cloud to look at any suspicious activities across the globe to become smarter and able to detect the threats. And we've had one incident on campus where an individual's computer was compromised, and the system caught it early enough that it didn't cause any other problems on campus. So we have seen its effectiveness, and it does alert us and our IT staff to be able to address any issues. So anyway, that we began deploying about a year ago, and we'll continue to deploy it across the rest of campus over the next couple of years. Another area we've been working on is network system upgrades, because the demands on our systems continue to grow. More speed, more capacity, more everything. It's always out there, always in demand. And what we're doing now is we run what's called a hyper-convergence server platform, and we're going to be moving to a VMware stretch cluster design, which is virtual servers. We'll be locating three sets of servers in 2 locations on campus. And what that does is we have the geography protection of keeping it in 2 different areas, but also as anything goes down, it has continuous runnability if one's attacked versus the other. And so So that is a big piece that we're working on over the next year. Also, another area that's close to that is the backup systems. We have multiple backup systems, and everybody moved to digital tape backups, and we did that too. And we have two forms of digital tape backups. One is writable to, another one is not writable to. And so if somebody compromises, they can't write to the disk when it's compromised. But the other thing we did is we went old school, and we started not only doing digital backups, we started going back to the tape backups and moving them off site. So if people were infiltrating our systems, we'd have the ability to get to tape backups, which then we could potentially restore the system as long as we can identify there's not a breach within that area. And finally, two more pieces, actually. We have an information security operations group, and they call themselves CISO. And they were put in place to evaluate cybersecurity across the campus. And one of its essential tasks is to review requested products and software packages that come from departments to determine if the requested products follow best cybersecurity practices in regards to login, data storage, data retention, and data destruction rules. And that's important because there's a lot of vulnerabilities out there in your third-party software vendors that may host some of your data. And so you also have to not only watch out for your data, but you gotta look for other people that may be storing some of your data. And so that's another key piece. And then the final one that we just started working on, and I'm on the mayor board, and it's called MySOC. And because of these challenges, we were looking at ways of how can we really have a real high-end security operations center monitoring our networks. It's something none of the regional publics can afford it on their own. But we looked at it and we said if we combine our resources, this may be something where we can really have a super high-end security operations center that's really addressing not just our needs, but all the schools' needs. And you'd have 24/7 personnel looking over the systems. And so John and I are working on that with Merit, and hopefully by next year we'll have something in place on that. So there's a lot of things we're doing, but we're having to do a lot of things because a lot of people are trying to attack our networks. And whatever we do, we're going to probably do something different by next year because it's always a constantly evolving threat out there. So now I think I'm done with my piece. I can turn it to Brock, and then you can get out to dinner from here. So, or is there a question here? Here you go.
I only ask questions to Gavin. He paid me. No. No. I was just curious if you, this group, have a working relation with the cybersecurity program or the cybersecurity students. That, I mean, if you are doing this and they're studying that, I mean, yeah. It seems logical. That
John does work closely, I think, with the cybersecurity program here. He's sitting in the corner over there, so I'm pointing at him. John's sort of our lead guy on that. But, yeah, yes, we do work with that area. All right. Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Gavin. And thanks, Gavin and Chris and Jill and Rhea, Jeff, Dale. Thanks all for the presentations. Look, we are heading out, so I'm going to be very brief here. I hope you enjoyed the presentations. I hope you enjoyed the forum. We know these can be better. I think this is a really good start. The information for the University Assembly, the information for the forums are going to be posted on the President's office website, so you have an opportunity to look at the materials, watch the recordings. You decide you want to do that. But no, the information is there for you. And look, over time, that could be useful. You can kind of see this as an archive or repository of important topics on this campus. So please take the opportunity to weigh in and let us know how we can adjust these over time. This is not a performance. There's no ego involved here. This is an earnest effort to sort of share information with the campus community. And, you know, you'll be able to direct us in terms of what the right information is to share, how to structure it, how to encourage even more questions during these sessions, and how to encourage feedback and more questions outside of the sessions. And I'm going to wrap up by saying this, and I'll just kind of take a deep breath, and hopefully we can all reset before you head out the door. Okay. This university, this place, we're in a very special, I think very positive position moving forward. And I say that I haven't been around for 50 years or 60 years, but look, I'm going to tell you something. In Montana, the job that I had there was a really interesting job. I got to see 16 different campuses for 8.5 years or so from a kind of bird's eye view, all the way from two-year colleges to research one doctoral universities and everything in between, urban, it's as urban as it gets in Montana, rural, remote campuses. And then I was part of a national organization that was so connected to other states and campuses throughout the country. I know what's happening around the country, and I know where Northern falls within the national landscape. We have challenges, for sure. I mean, you know, and we can list them. This place is on the rise, and we have a tremendous opportunity to do great things. So many positive pieces are already in place. So earlier today, as one of these kind of interjections, I said, it's great that we're sitting here talking about investments, and we're talking about culture on campus, and we're talking about communication as a primary challenge. It's a fantastic thing that we have this opportunity to tackle these big challenges, but they're positive challenges to tackle. And I want to thank you for showing up today. 2 hours. Okay, 2 hours. But this is what it takes. Sometimes, and I know I've sat in the seats out there before, it's easy to just kind of retreat and adopt, I don't know, what maybe some cynicism or maybe some smugness and say, you know what, I know what we need to be doing. And if I were up there, I'd have it figured out. I can tell you, you wouldn't. I don't. None of the talented all-star folks that are up here have it all figured out. But together, we absolutely can figure it out or come as close as we can to figuring it out. We can do it. It does take time, energy, honesty. We can get there. I invite you back next semester for this forum. Many of you will have an opportunity to interact with my office, with the folks who presented today between now and then. Thank you again for all you're doing to make this university great. Let's look forward to a great second half of the semester. Be well. Let us know if there are things we can do with the structure of this in particular to improve the forum. Thanks again for being here this afternoon.